अस्सलाम वालेकुम, माय नेम इज डॉक्टर मोहम्मद शुएब एंड आवर टुडेज लेक्चर इज टू ग्रुप सी एक्स डिसकनेक्शन। द कंटेंट्स व्हिच वी आर गोना स्टडी आर वन ग्रुप एंड टू ग्रुप सी एक्स डिसकनेक्शंस। रिकॉग्नाइजिंग अ टू ग्रुप सी एक्स डिसकनेक्शन, वन थ्री डाई एक्स रिलेशनशिप and what happens if there is no carbonyl group, 1-2 diex relationship, 1-1 diex relationship and 2 group cx disconnection as a preliminary to a complete analysis. First of all, what is 1 group and 2 group cx disconnection? Cx disconnection mean carbon and hetero atom disconnection. For a sulfide, the disconnection of carbon and sulfur bond is very easy in an SN2 reaction. Here we have only one option. After CX disconnection, sulfide is nucleophile and alkyl bromide, the chain of alkyl behave as an electrophile. If the sulfide is of this structure, then there is a two group CX disconnection. Apparently, it seems the same as that of one group disconnection, but here the reagent which is equivalent to a synthone shows that it is a two group disconnection. In two group disconnection, we recruit another functional group which helps us to discover a better reagent. Here the carbonyl group can make the center in electrophilic reaction if we simply add a double bond to the structure. In two group disconnection, there are two functional groups which participate in a reaction. In this disconnection, it is reasonable to disconnect sulfur as a nucleophile and alkyl bromide as an electrophile. There is nothing wrong with this suggestion except that it ignores the other functional group, that is ketone, in the target molecule and so misses an opportunity for a two group disconnection. And reverting to a synthone for a moment, the sulfur synthone is the same in both disconnections as the reagent, but the carbon synthone might make us think of a different reagent. Here, the carbon synthone is different, and in two group disconnection, the carbon synthone is different. The reaction is conjugate addition of the thiolate anion to the enone, making an enolate intermediate that captures a proton to give a target molecule, and it again regenerates a nucleophile. This second route is far better than the first one, because in this route there is no need to waste an atom of bromine to provide a leaving group. The enone here is naturally electrophilic in the right carbon atom, and the two functional group in the target molecule in second path cooperate in making the new carbon sulfur bond. And here no strong acid base or high temperature is needed as the enolate intermediate regenerate the reagent, so only a catalytic weak base is needed. The bromide is likely to eliminate under the reaction conditions to give anyway. Next is recognizing the two group C-axis connection. How to recognize? The key step in recognizing the relationship between two functional groups is number the carbon atoms bearing the functional group. Here it is 1, 2 and 3. It does not matter which you call 1, only the relationship matters. Here we have a 1,3-diax relationship. The two functionalized carbon atoms have a 1,3 relationship. We can choose conjugate addition as our reaction and do the disconnection as we have already done. Instead, draw the synthone and decide which electrophile reagent to be used. One 3-diax relationship. For conjugate addition, it is essential to have an electron withdrawing group as here, and it is usually a carbonyl group, but it can also be some cyanide at the right position. The disconnection in general term is like this. The nucleophilic reagent will depend upon the heteroatom. If X given here is oxygen or sulfur, we need a base. But if X is equal to nitrogen, the amine itself should be a nucleophile enough to do the conjugate addition. An example would be the amino ester given here. Numbering the carbon atom reveals a 1,3 relationship, and CN disconnection gives the secondary amine and ethyl acrylate as a reagent. How do we control whether the nucleophile adds direct to the carbonyl group or by conjugate addition? Very electrophilic compounds such as acid chlorides or aldehydes tends to prefer direct addition, while the less electrophilic compounds such as esters or ketones tend to do conjugate addition. Here it is a conjugate addition. If X is equal to OR or R, ester or ketone, the result is conjugate addition. And if X is halide or hydrogen, that there is direct addition. And what if there is no carbonyl group? The given amino alcohol has a 1,3-diax relationship but no carbonyl group. So we introduce 1 by FGI. We could have an ester or an aldehyde. An aldehyde would be easier to reduce, but there is a danger of direct addition. So we choose an ester. Here, FG brings about the ester group. And here is a 1,3-diax relationship. The synthesis is very straightforward, and we shall need lithium aluminium hydride to reduce ester. Phenyl methane amine react with methyl methacrylate, and after reduction, it gives the target molecule. Suppose if we don't have a carbonyl group and neither we have any oxygen based functionality, as in the diamine. It is not necessary to have a carbonyl group for conjugate addition. In fact, any electron withdrawing group such as nitrile here, it is much better. So we do FGI. We convert CH2 NH2 into cyanide or nitrile. In fact, We do FJ on the primary amine and disconnect the secondary amine from acrylonitrile. The synthesis is to mix the two and reduce catalytically or with lithium aluminium hydride. Here are the examples of 1,3 difunctionalized compound. For example, enantiomerically pure chloroester is disconnected from the ester and we get 1,3 diethylation ship. Then alcohol is converted into ester by FGI and is broken down. The chloride can be added as a conjugate addition. Here we take the acer itself as a starting material for the conjugate addition. HCl is added to obtain 3-chlorobutanoic acid, which is a racemic mixture. It can be resolved as a quinine salt, and after that reduction with lithium aluminium hydride and esterification gives us the target molecule. The amino ether containing a 7-member ring has a 1,3 relationship but no carbonyl group. We can remove the 7-member ring and put a carbonyl group at C3. But a shorter synthesis comes from the nitrile, as we can add the alcohol in one piece to the acrylonitrile. The synthesis is very simple in 2-step process with catalytic hydrogenation used for the reduction of the nitrile. In first step it is a conjugate addition, and in the second step it is a reduction. We use the second functionality to make the right carbon atom as an electrophilic carbon. Here the amino, thio and alkoxy alcohols all fit the pattern and can be disconnected to the usual heteroatom nucleophile and the synthone. Heteroatom is a nucleophile and carbon atom is an electrophile. How can we use OH group at C1 to make C2 electrophile? That is, OH is present at one carbon and to the adjacent carbon we have to make it as an electrophilic center. The one way is to visualize the answer is to imagine what would happen if we actually made the cation. It would instantly cyclize to form epoxide. It is a saturated ether and reacts with nucleophiles such as amine to give amino alcohols, thio alcohols or alkoxy alcohols. Here is a reaction. There is no problem in such symmetrical epoxide where nucleophile can attack on either side. The product is same. But if there is a substituent as shown here, the nucleophile can attack at both carbon, but in actual practice it will attack only less substituted end of the 3-member ring, so only one product is formed. The disconnection given here, it gives a different synthone, and the best reagent for these type of synthone are the alpha halocarbonyl compound. At first this looks like one group disconnection, that only bromine bearing carbon is involved, but actually it isn't. The presence of carbonyl group makes the SN2 displacement of halide enormously faster, and the alpha halocarbonyl compounds are made from the ketones by the acid catalyzed halogenation of the enol. By this reaction, alpha halogenation is easily possible. Examples of 1,2 difunctionalized compound. The ether given here, it was needed to study the chelation rearrangement and can be disconnected in 1,2 diex fashion, as it provides an alcohol and an epoxide. The synthesis is simple. It involves the treating of allyl alcohol with sodium hydride to make an anion, and combining with the epoxide easily made from the styrene, this epoxide can be easily prepared by the epoxidation of styrene. Here we get the target molecule. Compounds like ester given here are briefly mentioned here, and we can now show how they can be made by a two group CX disconnection. Here the electrophile will be the alpha halocarbonyl compounds, and the nucleophile will be different from the previous one. Here the nucleophile is an anion of carboxylic acid, that is carboxylate ion. The bromide is made by the direct bromination in the presence of acetic acid, as studied earlier, and only the very weak base like sodium bicarbonate is enough to deprotonate the carboxylic acid and make it anion. By reacting both these, we get the target molecule. Here the carboxylate ion RCOO negative will attack the carbon, which is electrophilic in nature, and it will displace bromine, and we get the target molecule. Antifungal compound fluconazole is more advanced example of such a disconnection. It has 2-1-2 diex relationship between nitrogen and the OH group. We might think that we can make both the same way, but it is not possible. The first disconnection, 1-2 disconnection, is very easy. We get a triazole and an epoxide, and this epoxide can be easily prepared from a ketone by Wittig reagent or elide chemistry. This ketone is converted into an alkene, and by epoxidation we get an epoxide. But how to prepare, how to get this ketone? It is again 1-2 diex. So when we disconnect here, we obtain another molecule of triazole. And this ketone can easily be prepared by Friedel-Crafts reaction using available chloroacetyl chloride. The synthesis follows here will be exactly the reverse of disconnection. Next is 1-1 diex relationship. The label 1-1 diex may look strange, but all it means is that only two functional groups are joined to the same carbon atom, as shown here. We already know how to make acetyl. Acetyls are prepared by the reaction of an aldehyde with an alcohol in acidic solution. The disconnection is therefore of both carbon-oxygen bonds. This reveals a valuable truth, that is, if two heteroatoms joined to the same carbon atom are at the carbonyl oxidation level, and the target molecule is probably made from the carbonyl group. Again, we may think that we are not using the two-group cooperation, but actually we are using the two-group cooperation. The key step in acetyl formation and the hydrolysis is the expulsion of one OR group. In the synthesis, protonation of the hemiacetyl, which is formed in the first step, followed by the expulsion of molecule of water, and the addition of second molecule of methanol is possible because of the first one. In the hydrolysis, these steps happen in reverse. Acetyls are not just ethers, they are much more reactive compounds because of the two OR groups joined to the same carbon. So, if the two heteroatoms are the same, it is usually best to disconnect both CX bonds, choosing the ones to the same carbon atoms and write the carbonyl group at that, as shown here. This heterocycle has two CN bonds to the same carbon. If we disconnect both by 1-1 diethyl relationship, we get a cyclohexanone and very unstable looking imine. We know how to make imines, combining a carbonyl group and an amine. So disconnecting both imines, we end up with a diketone and two molecules of ammonia. Another possibility is that the imine is disconnected first. It takes us directly to the diketone and a very unstable diamine. But here again, 1-1 diex leads us to the cyclohexanol and ammonia. In both cases, we obtain the same reagent or starting materials. Here is another example of 1-1 diex relationship. If the heteroatoms are different and one of them is oxygen, it makes more sense to disconnect the other so that the oxygen of the carbonyl group remains intact. The phosphonate given below is an example. The nucleophilic synthone can be made by deprotonation of dialkyl phosphonate. Here is a synthone and here is a dialkyl phosphonate. This chemistry is not very familiar. Therefore, we must know that diethyl phosphite or diethyl phosphonate is available commercially, and in the presence of base, they form an anion, and when anion reacts with an aldehyde, we obtain a target molecule, which is diethyl 1-hydroxyethyl phosphonate. Here, two group CX disconnection, it is a preliminary to a full analysis. It is a complex molecule, a polycyclic cage-like structure of the natural product, saracenine. It appears to be a very unusual and formidable target for the synthesis. It has several CO bonds. So first, very obvious 1-1 di-O relationship is that where the acetyl is formed. It indicates a hidden carbonyl, and after 1-1 di-O, we obtain an aldehyde and two OH groups. Again, it is a hemiacetal. And when we again break by 1-1 di-O, we obtain an aldehyde and an OH group. It is enol and can be tetramerized to an aldehyde group as given here. When it is redrawn, as we take this CHO to the upper side of this molecule and we redraw, this OH and CHO can be masked by a double bond, and this CHO and CHO, two aldehyde groups, can also be joined to form a double bond. And in synthesis, this double bond cleavage is possible by ozonolysis. And that was all about two group CX disconnection.